behalf of Kaju Samuzong Cape Town, I would like to warmly welcome you and thank you so much for coming to see us. I think my voice is loud enough. We welcome you very much here in our Cape Town Centre. We're very privileged to have you here. Lama Yeshe emailed me, so did Lama Zangmo, and they said, I must make sure that when you're in Cape Town, you come to our centre. So we're very, very happy to have you here. We also would like to thank you very much for the hundreds and thousands of prayers that you have devoted to the swift return of Akko Rinpoche. And we very much appreciate that. And we would also like you tonight to please, in your talk to us, please tell us a little bit about how we can continue Rinpoche's work in Africa and what we can do to fulfill Akko Rinpoche's dream in Africa. Thank you very much, and I hope you have a wonderful visit here.
因为今天就翻译的原因，就是我用汉语讲，然后用英语来翻译。 今天也很高兴，来到这个我第一次来到这个南非的开普敦，然后跟该这个中心呢。 就关于菩提心方面的一些交谈。So
today I'm very glad to be here in South Africa and in this place, Cape Town, and also I think it's my great pleasure to be here in this specific center to give a teaching on bodhicitta.
很多人会比较清楚的，也有可能个别人不一定特别明白。实际上，就是所谓的菩提心呢，是释迦牟尼佛所宣说的有八万四千法门，但八万四千法门的所有的醍醐精华，集中起来的话，就是宣说菩提心，因此。 我们无论是在理论上的了解，或者说是他的实际的这种修行，菩提心的教义呢，应该说对每个人来讲是非常的重要。So
I think about bodhicitta, maybe the majority of you already know about it, but maybe some of you do not understand it in a deeper level. And from all the teachings, all the 8400 teachings from Buddha Shakyamuni, bodhicitta is the quite essence of all the teachings in a summarized way. So for all the people on the level of theories or your practice, from both aspects, bodhicitta is the most important thing.
它不仅是修学大乘佛教的人来讲是非常重要的，更重要的，凡是我们这个世界上的 任何的这个生命，任何的这种人类来讲，它是它的价值就无法这个估量的。
So bodhicitta is not only important for Mahayana practitioners, it's also very, very important for all living beings, not just the human beings. Its value is indescribable.
我们大家都知道，我们生存在这个地球上呢，从肤色方面讲，有白种人、黑种人，还有黄种人。然后从整个区域来分的话呢，有非洲啊、亚洲啊，还有这个欧洲啊，还有这个美洲啊、大洋洲，就是整个五大洲。然后从国家来讲呢，就是实际上是有200多个国家。而我们的整个文化来说呢，那这个千差万别的非常非常就是多的，所以我们从不同的种类和不同的这种习俗来讲呢，好像是我们在这个地球上呢，就是都互不相干，就是每个人有各自的就是不同的一些这个传承，和他有他的一些这个这种文化和语言。
So it looks like we are very different. Living in this world, we have different group of people. First thing, maybe we can talk about the skin color. We have black people, white people, and colored people. And also from the regions geographically, we have Asia, Africa, Europe, America, and also Oceania. And also there are more than 200 countries.And all the cultures are very diverse. And also we have different traditions. So it looks like we are all very different. We have different lineage, different culture, and different language.
关于这方面呢，就是在印度，非常著名的这吉天论社。那么吉天论社他在这个如菩萨心论。就是《如菩萨行论》，在这个论点当中呢，就是讲过一个非常重要的一句话，也就是他是怎么说的呢？就是说，孰当清观修，自他本平等，避苦求乐通，护他济，护他入护济，就是有这么一句话。那么这句话呢，其实，它是应该在大概是80世纪，就是在那个时候就说的。但是它的这个思想呢，应该说是，当今我们这个人类已经迈进21世纪，这个时候也是全球的人类来讲，应该可以从中能汲取就是思想的最，精髓的部分。
As early as the 8th century in India, a great scholar called Shantideva, in his work, The Bodhisattva Way of Life, he said a very important remark. He said, first thing that we need to do, we need to meditate on, is the equality of ourselves and others. Because we all seek happiness, we all want to avoid suffering. So we should protect others as we protect ourselves.Although this was said in this 8th century, very long ago, but till now, in the 21st century, it's still the great thing, the quite essence that all human beings in this world should learn from.
因此这句话就说明了，我们全球上的所有的这些人类来讲，表面上的确有非常多的差异，不同的地方。但是我们唯一的共同的地方呢，我们应该首先就是明白这个道理。当我们明白这个道理之后呢，要去很精勤的去思考，思考什么样的问题呢？首先就是第一个，也就是说我们所有的人呢，就是说自己和他人应该是平等的。哪些方面平等的呢？ 就是我们不管是东方人还是西方人，追求自己的这种快乐，避开就是自己在生活当中或者说是身心当中的这些痛苦，这是完全都是相通的，完全都是相通的。那么就是因为我们有这样的共同点的话呢，那我们就像保护自己一样，就是要保护他人，就是这是一个非常原则性的。表面上看到好像这个偈颂呢，这句话呢就是很简单的，但实际上呢，我们如果很心静下来去思维的时候，哇，就是原来在这个里面有的确是有这么一个深深的这个意义。
And so from this verse, what we can learn is, although we look like very different from each other, all the people in this world or globally, we are very different, but we have something in common, which is exceptional. That is, we are all equal. And what makes us equal is,No matter we are from the east or from the west or from no matter what place we are from, we all want to get happiness, gain happiness, acquire happiness. We all do not want suffering. This is something make us all in common. No matter it's in our daily life or physically or mentally, we all wish happiness. And so when we think about this, then we should think deeply.And then you will find, when you want to protect yourself, you should understand other people also want to be helped or protected. So we should go out to help and protect other people just like we want to protect ourselves or cherish ourselves. So although this is a very simple, very plain statement, but if you think it deeply, you will find it's a fundamental thing for all human beings, for all living beings, and it has profound meaning inside.
这是在大乘的这个菩提行为当中呢，就是叫做是自他平等。也就是说我们通过一种换位思考，这种换位思考也可以叫自他交换。什么样才叫做自他交换呢？比如说我们杀害别人，那么那个时候如果我们会站在他的角度来讲，如果我是他，那么别人来夺我的命，就是杀害我，端出我的这种会，端出我的性命，就是看什么样的痛苦。就这个时候，你会感觉得到，原来别人的生命呢，也是极其可贵。
So, when we talk about the bodhicitta in Mahayana Buddhism, we should first think about the equality of ourselves and others.And also, we can think it in the way we use in daily life, which is think in others' shoes. That's what we use a lot in our daily life. And also, we should use exchange of ourselves and others, that thing. For example, if you want to harm someone or even kill someone, then you should think, if now someone is going to kill me, I will be the person who will be killed.What kind of feeling you should have, or you will have. You may have fear, or you have some other feelings. Just thinking that way, in the shoes of others, you can find out all the lives are precious. Maybe we should not do that.
这样的自他交换，或者说我们刚才讲的，就是自己跟他人完全相通的，去扩闭了方面相通的，这种理念呢，就是实际上是菩提心的一种最根本的修法。
And this kind of exchange ourselves with others, or all human beings, or all creatures, or all living beings are equal, is a very fundamental practice for bodhicitta, for cultivating bodhicitta.
我们如果研究佛教，或者说是修行佛教的话呢，那么。它有一个非常深深的意义。我看现在很多人呢，可能会讲一些慈悲啊，就是善良啊，就是这方面的。但是更重要的一些菩提心，尤其是菩提心呢，它直接涉及到我们每一个众生的解脱， 那这种道理，如果我们佛教徒不懂的话，可能我们学的不一定很深奥。
So nowadays a lot of people are studying Buddhism or practice Buddhism, but the profound meaning or profound theories in Buddhism are not really studied at an adequate level because we all talk about compassion or be kind or be virtuous. That's something we emphasize a lot in our practice. But the more profound thing, such as bodhicitta, is not adequately studied or emphasized because bodhicitta is really related to our liberation. That is a very unique thing in Buddhism. If you don't understand bodhicitta in the correct way or adequate way, then your practice cannot be very successful. It cannot really touch the point.
菩提心有圆菩提心和性菩提心。所谓的圆菩提心，就我从现在开始要度化无量无边的众生，而且让他们获得真正的觉悟的果位，就这就是说一种发愿，就是这叫做圆菩提心。我相信我们很多人理论上会懂的。
And so bodhicitta, if you look at it, it can fall into two categories. One is aspiration bodhicitta, the other one is action bodhicitta. For aspiration bodhicitta, that is, we make the aspiration from today, I will go out.To work hard to liberate all sentient beings, infinite sentient beings, and I will place them in the place of enlightenment. I will help them to reach enlightenment. That is one thing that we should understand. That is the aspiration of bodhicitta.
然而，在圆菩提心的基础上呢，我们要性菩提心。性菩提心就是说，你要发愿。就是度无量无边的这些众生，让他们获得真正的觉悟果位。在这样的发愿的基础上呢，我们实际行动，也就是说布施、持戒、安忍，还有这个禅定、精进、智慧六种波罗蜜多，通过这种方式来不断的去努力。那么这是我们就是如果你真的要发了这个大乘的这个性的话呢，那你可能没有自己的这种享乐啊、懒惰啊、懈怠啊，包括就是对自己的这种自我保护的很多很多的这种利诱啊，就是这些，不一定就是对适合的。
So the second one is action bodhicitta, that is on the top of aspiration bodhicitta, which is.I will go to do the thing. I will go to help all sentient beings become enlightened, that aspiration. On top of that, we will go out to do the six perfections or six paramitas, that is, practice generosity and our ethical discipline, and also tolerance meditative concentration and wisdom, and six of them. And then,Because after we generate the Mahayana bodhicitta, we will think all about other sentient beings. So we will not have the reasons or excuses to think too much about ourselves, to be too self-cherishing, or we will not be very lazy because our job is to help other sentient beings. And that is a good way for us to be diligently to do a lot of the Dharma practice and help other sentient beings.
有些人可能认为，这个利益他众呢，虽然这是一个很好的一种心态，但是，我们自己的这种自尊心、自我的这种，很坚强的，就是自我的一种勇敢，这个是更重要的，因为自己有一种自信和自强，就是这很需要的，所以可能觉得一提起利益众生的时候呢。 有种心理就是无法接受啊，或者说是觉得以自己的这种自私心呢跟利他心之间就是经常发生一些冲突，这个时候没办法就是心持这个利他的事业。
So when we talk about to benefit other sentient beings, help other sentient beings, we may think theoretically this is a very good thing for us to do, but because we are so habitually, familiarized with the thinking of self-centered way, because we are very selfish, we always think about ourselves. So when we are taught to be altruistic,We just feel there are some conflicts because we want to have more things think about or have more thinking about ourselves, about our own benefit or interests. So we think about, oh, I should be very, I should have self-confidence. My self-esteem, that's something more important than helping other sentient beings because we all think too much about ourselves.
虽然我们有这种想法，但是这个想法呢，到底是正确还是不正确，我们也要搞去观察，因为我们很认真的去研究的话，也许我们人类在历史上发生的有些事情呢，到后来的时候观察起来就是不一定是很正确的。虽然我们有这样的习惯，但是这种习惯是非常正确的话，我们继续再坚持下去。如果我们这样的观念呢，虽然从这个几百年、几千年一直延续到今天，但是这种观念也许可能对我自身、对整个来自全球的所有的生命来讲不利的话呢，我们要尽量的要改变自己的这种老的观念和老的思想。
Maybe this kind of teaching, or maybe this kind of idea conflicts with our own thinking, our selfish thinking, but we should really look at it, analyze it, if it's correct or incorrect. Because if we look back on the human history, we know there are a lot of things that happened. Some of them are not that correct. Some of them may be correct. But it's just because we have this kind of habitual tendency,To think in that way, we should think, then we think maybe I should just follow what I think is correct. However, that does not mean it is really correct. We should really analyze it. If this kind of thinking is correct, then we can continue that thinking and continue what we're doing. But if it's not correct, we should change it, correct our wrong views. And if...Some of our views, our ideas, really harm not only ourselves, but also other beings in the world. We should really correct that, no matter how old it is, how stubborn it is. We should work on it, change it, correct it.
今天就是说我们全球上的人类，全部都是应该是平等的。就很多方面呢，我们觉得是人类要有一种平等的共同发展，这个思想和这种说法呢，就是也许很多人是接受的，但是现在这样的这种说法，也许早在30年、40年前说的话呢，有相当一部分人呢，也许就是这个观点，包括黑人和白人之间的这种各方面的一些宗族的这个冲突和歧视来讲呢，也许这个观点是当时许许多多人是不认可的。
Now, when we talk about equality of all human beings in this world, on this globe, maybe the majority will think that is acceptable. We think it is good or it is correct for all human beings to be equal. But if this issue is raised, this race issue is raised up back 3 or 4 decades ago, maybe some of the people don't.Think, or they cannot accept this idea.
我昨天刚到这个开普敦兰菲啊，就这个时候呢，他们很多人给我介绍，就是说是原来就是这个 这个南非总统曼德拉就是在那个海岛上，就是已经在监狱里，就待了很多年，因为他的整个不同的三个监狱当中，总共已经待了27年了。然后我也以前看过他的一些传记，然后我就一直在思考，就是像其实我们人类历史上就是所发生的很多很多的这些历史呢，也证明就是我们的这个观念呢，也有正确的，也有不正确的。
So yesterday when I arrived in Cape Town, I was told, so in the past, when the first black president Mandela became a president, before that, he had served in prison for 27 years total in three different prisons. And I also read his biography before. And so I think that kind of reminded me about the idea that although we human beings have our different ideas, but if you look at it, you will find some of our ideas are correct, some of them are not.
当然关于这个问题呢，就是如果你们有不同的这种观点的话，就是当一会儿问答期间呢，也可以提出来。但是从这个当时的，可以这么说吧，就是因为它是真实一个历史当中发生的这个事情呢。当时我们这个白种人呢，就是对各里这个黑人呢，那么这样的这种这个思想呢，就是其实。当时认为是这是应该，就是很多对这个白种人来讲是应该是这个正确的，但是到今天的时候呢，可能虽然有就各个国家呢就是有不同的一些观点和还有一些，但是从大多数的这个民众来讲呢，就是绝对是我们人类呢就是同存在这个地球上的话呢，那么比库奇丘勒的话呢应该是这个等同的，就是大家有这样的一种公认和公民。
So about this issue, I think maybe some of you may hold different views, and if you do, you can bring it up during our question and answer session. But I think because this is a true story in the history, so we should look at it in an objective way.And about the race issue, black-white, I think at that time, historically, at that stage of the history, maybe it was correct, or some of the white people think this is correct for them to do that. But I think nowadays, maybe different countries, different nations have different standpoint view on this issue. But I think...one basic thing is everyone in this world and all have this common feature, that is, we all want happiness, we all do not want suffering. That is something true for everyone.
当然当时所发生的这些事情呢，实际上可能也涉及到一些政治，也涉及到一些宗教，也涉及到一些当时的人们的一些这个包括一些统治者的想法和各种情况吧。
And I think maybe this story or everything about this kind of thing, they must have something to do with the politics, religion, and also the particular ideas or thoughts of the rulers at that time.
我经常记起一个比较好奇的，也是。就心里比较也是重视的一句话，以前1984年获得了诺贝尔奖的图图教授，他有一次在纽约的一个演讲上呢，他是这样讲过，他说白人就是刚刚白人船家是刚刚来到非洲的时候呢，他们手里拉着这个圣经，我们黑人呢就是手里有这个土地，然后白人传教士呢就是告诉我们就是共同这个祈祷，然后我们闭着眼睛祈祷，然后后来睁开眼睛的时候呢，实际上不同的一些颠倒的这个情况发生了，那么圣经呢还是在我们手里，但是土地呢就是拉到 待人的这个树立。所以这句话呢，也许可能我们今天就是很多听众是拜认的，就是也许可能绝对是有不同的看法，但是我是今天是以按照自他交换或者说自他平等的很公正的线上面呢，我们以换位思考的方式来想的话呢，不知道大家有如何共鸣。
1984, Archbishop Tutu, he said something in a speech in New York after he got the Nobel Peace Prize. It's a little bit funny, but because today's audience, most of you are white people, I don't know, maybe you will have different view about this, but let's see what you think about. He said something. So when white people first came to Africa, they have the priests, they have Bible in their hands. And we African people have our land in our hands. But then the priests said, let's pray. Then we closed our eyes, we pray. But when we open our eyes, everything changed. It reversed. The Bible is in our hand, but our land in the white people's hands. Maybe you have some different views about this, but today, because we are from the angle of self exchange of ourselves and others, and also we are equal, so I think maybe you can think in that angle or aspect.
但我想，如果，那个图图教授啊，他现在在也30年已经过去了，他如果再睁开眼睛一看的时候呢，可能，黑人书里的很多圣经呢，就是就不见了，白人书里的很多土地呢也不见了，就是还是落在黑人书里。
The Bishop Tutu, want to give a statement again after 30 years. Right now, if he's going to talk about this, he may change it a little bit. He may say, when we open eyes, the Bible in black people's hands are gone. And also, the land in white people's hands are partially gone, or something like that.
因为94年这个曼德拉上来以后，就他也当时在他的就职演讲上就是说过，现在这块土地上呢，就是我们终也成了自己是我们自己的主人。然后从此之后呢，有相当大的这些地呢，就是也是落在他们自己的主人的手里。然后很多年轻人的本来是哪里，不管是黑人，不管是白人，但他们手里拿着的这种圣经或者心灵的这种信仰呢，现在基本上都是已经放弃了。所以现在在英国，在美国，在非洲，在哪个国家的话，真正有信仰的人，对基督教，对伊斯兰教，对佛教等等这些信仰的人呢，就开始越来越少了。所以说我们现在呢，如果偷偷就是再看的话呢，可能世界上的很多的这种状况呢也有所变化。
This is also there are something Mandela also said in 1994 in his inauguration speech. One of the sentences he said was, so we finally become the host of our own land, something like that. So if we look at the current situation, the Bibles in people's hands, no matter white or blank, and their belief, the faith in our heart also kind of decrease. It's globally, not just in one place. If you look at Europe, you look at UK or America, and also Africa here, you will find people who used to be Christian, in following Christianity, Islam, or Buddhism, the number of believers decreased dramatically. So this is something that is changing in the world.
这是我刚才要想说的，我们人类是应该是平等的，但是呢，在某个时代和某个时代当中，或者说是在某个观念的这种趋势下呢，就是可能会有不同的变化。我听说在非洲呢就不是那么严重，但是在别的一些包括欧美其他国家的话呢，当时他们对黑人的这种残暴非常的这种可怕，包括我所在的一些地方的话呢，也有很多民族的歧视啊，或者说人与人之间对仆人的这种虐待，他的一些杀戮就跟我们现在的跟杀动物就是一模一样的。其实这种理念呢，我们用一个菩提心的自他平等的尘来衡量的时候呢，是可以称之为是完全是错误的。
And so, we think all human beings should be equal, but at some particular time, or because of some of the ideas at some particular time, it may not be practiced in a correct way. I think maybe here in Africa, maybe it's not necessarily that dramatic or obvious.But in America or other places, we also see a very cruel thing happened to black people or some of the minority. The discrimination brings the death of slavers or servants. That's something we all see very cruel from our point of view of this time. So I thinkIt's very, very important for us to think or to use this idea of equality of ourselves and others.
那么我们修一个大乘菩提心的时候呢，对所有的众生，我今天更要想说的呢，我们人类就是对动物的虐待，对其他众生的杀戮的话呢，那就是这是一个非常违背菩提心的一种行为。
To help all sentient beings become a Buddha or reach enlightenment. However, I think I want to use this opportunity to emphasize that our misdeeds on animals or other beings, because if we kill animals or harm other sentient beings, that directly contradict with bodhicitta.
所以我们今天的人类的很多人的观念呢，就绝对是除了我们人类以外的什么羊啊、牛啊，或者说是包括一些海里的这个水生动物啊，还有废弃呢啊，就是这些呢，我们人类除了极个别的，比如说一些什么和平鸽啊，就是个别的一些动物以外呢，大家都绝对是应该把它吃掉的，你应该把它杀害的。我们应该人类把它吃掉的，而没有想到就是他们有同样的痛苦，没有想到他们也需要就是快乐。那么这一点就是我们人类虽然是现在自己认为是我们是一个高等动物，应该我们的智商很高，可是呢可能我们还有就是在这个思维呢就是没有跟上就是这个道理。
So today most of us think that maybe some of the animals we should protect. Maybe the sheep in your on the mountains that maybe you're herding, and the cows, birds, seals, some sea and marine creatures, and also like pigeons, which symbolizes peace, something like that. We think we should protect those kind of animals. But for all the other animals that may be served for our meal, then we think they should be killed because we're going to eat them. If we don't kill them, how can we eat them? We really need meat in our meals. So we think that is a natural thing for us to kill those animals. But this is because we are not thinking that they also suffer. They also need happiness. They also really wish for happiness, seek for happiness. So I think we human beings are more advanced animals, but actually we are not thinking enough about other beings or other animals.
因此，我们修行菩提心的人来讲，光自己可能即生当中，快乐啊，即生当中健康啊，就这样的心态呢，就是这根本谈不上菩提心。所谓的菩提心，就是让所有的众生，让他们获得了最高的、最好的一种快乐。那么，这就是真正的菩提心的教义的这种核心所在。
So when we talk about cultivating bodhicitta, if we only think about I will be happy, should I do something to make myself happy or more healthy? This has nothing to do with bodhicitta. This is not bodhicitta at all. For us to do practice on bodhicitta or cultivate bodhicitta, we should think we should bring the ultimate happiness for all sentient beings.
因为这些动物呢就像我们几百年前就是世界上的个别的一些非常就是脆弱的这个民族一样就是当时的这些民族一样的那么都是我们在人类的这个树里就干涉就是各种残暴和虐待或者说是我们就是杀害就断除了他们的非常珍可贵的这种性命，所以我们现在每天在世界上所发生的许许多多的残害众生的行为呢，应该说是从大乘佛子的眼光来看呢，这是非常这个残酷的，也是极其可悲的。
So when we think about this, now if we kill animals, you should think it.Just several centuries ago, when some vulnerable ethnic groups were mistreated or killed by other human beings, that's something very similar. So if we still or continue to kill animals in this way, then you will find it's just like some of the human beings kill some of other human beings.It's really cruel.
关于对所有的动物的这些保护方面呢，我们学习大乘佛教的人，不管是西方人还是东方人，都应该要值得引起思考。为什么这么讲呢？我们学可能藏传佛教的，还要学西方的这个不同教派的很多人呢，可能我们有个毛病，就是经常就是食用一些肉食，当然我们知道是每个人就是喜欢吃肉，但实际上呢，它直接会间接就涉及到就是损害这个众生的生命。
So when we talk about animal protection or animal rights, no matter we are from the east or the west, I think this is something really worth thinking. We should really think about it deeply.When we talk about Tibetan Buddhism or other schools, other sect of Buddhism, I think one thing that we should really remind ourselves is about eating meat. Although a lot of people like to eat meat, but I think if you eat meat, you should understand it's directly or indirectly harm other sentient beings because that is a way to take their life, directly or indirectly.
如果我们不能长期吃素呢，也是要习惯，一个月当中4天，或者说 半个月，或者至少也是一个礼拜当中一天啊等等，就是以这种方式来锻炼观念，就是改变我们的观念。因为我们说食用的动物的肉呢，实际上就我们食用这个众生的生命就没有什么差别的，根据楞严经和涅槃经的观点言。
So if we cannot make the aspiration, or if we cannot make it for us to have vegetarian food or meal in the rest of our life or in a long term, what we can do or what we can try is to have vegetarian meal 4 days a month, or half of the month we have a vegetarian food, or maybe at least 1 day in a week. That's something we can try, we can start with. And through this kind of action or practice, we can change our habitual thinking that animals or meat are things that we should eat or consume naturally. Because if you think when you are eating meat, that is the same as taking the life of animals.
佛教徒关于不吃肉食方面呢，我是最赞叹的汉传佛教，因为汉传佛教呢，一千多年的这个历史啊，到现在也是保持着一个非常非常完整、非常完美的就是一个传统。这一点，我认为应该全球的具有这个慈悲心的这些教徒呢，就是都应该向他们学习。那么自己呢，就是也应该反复思考。
And so the last one, that one also was recorded, or that statement also recorded in the Nirvana Sutra. I just forget that one. And then next, this time. So for all the Buddhists who are not eating meat, I think what is a good thing is this should be praised of, especially for the Chinese Buddhism, because they emphasize a lot on vegetarian meals. And this tradition, this habit that they have, has already have a history over 1,000 years. And I think all the people who are practicing compassion should follow what they are doing. They are a very good example for us.
汉地素食观呢，我以前关于这方面也研究过，实际上是它是最开始的时候与汉地的文化有关系。刚开始有一个叫《黄帝内经》，就《黄帝内经》里面就是说，这个五谷为养，五谷为主，意思就是说我们这个五种谷粮呢，就是对自己的身体就是有主要的这个营养作用。五种果实呢，就是对自己的身体也是成为这个帮助这个消化和身体呢，就是有健康的这个作用。
And so when we talk about vegetarian meals or vegetarian diet in Tibet, in Chinese Buddhism, we can look at the culture of Chinese area, and I also studied on this because at the first beginning.In the Yano Emperor's inner canon, it recorded, so we should primarily depend on or live on the five kinds of greens. And then the five kinds of fruits are just a supplementary nutrition for us.
后来有很多儒教的一些，包括这个孔孟的一些思想家的这个影响，然后到了这个梁武帝，在那个时候呢，他有一次应该记得，公元511年，在那个时候呢，他对汉地的佛教徒专门就是写一个断酒肉文，就是断除这个喝酒和吃肉的，就是这么一个文章。就然后呢，就是整个全国就是下司令，就是下命令，就凡是这个出家人，刚开始是出家人，就是不能吃肉，不能喝酒。然后这个影响呢，就是慢慢就是。涉及到就是所有的这个佛教徒。
So and also in Confucianism, we can find out in the time of the 511 year after in the year of 511, Emperor Liang Wu also kind of give a regulation for all the people in China to all the Buddhists in China to restrain from eating or consuming meat or alcohol. And at first, this was applied to monastics, and later, this was applied for all the Buddhists.
因为梁武帝当时整个就是在这个汉地啊，就是他的这个持政能力非常强，包括他的这个公主呢，就是后来在达摩住持前面是一个比丘尼，就他们家的这个佛缘就是很殊胜。那通过他的这种影响力呢，到今天就是有应该是1504年是吧？1504年呢，应该1504年那个时候你们这个非洲大陆啊，就是非洲大陆可能是念这里有没有一个原始的这种部落啊，就好像没有，就是白种人白人来的时候都是以300多年前吧。那这样的话呢，汉地从1500年前就是一直把这个术士观呢，就是到今天，我就是有一种好奇，觉得是其他的有些思想呢可能先暂时传开，但是最后人族差量就是可能国王死了就是又恢复了。可是这个术士观呢一直到今天，就是在凡是汉传佛教的寺院里面和包括有些在家的居士呢几乎都不吃肉，就是几乎都不吃肉。我也刚才问了，我说我们这个开普敦的汉传佛教的这个汉传佛教徒呢就是吃不吃肉，就是他们给我回答吃的不是特别多，就是所以可能他们现在可能受到其他这个佛教的影响，就是可能吃的不是特别多，可能吃的少一点，就是可能会有的。但是这个是可能我像这个受其他影响的，应该不是汉传佛教本土的这个就佛教的影响。
So at that time, Emperor Liang Wu he was very powerful, and so he has a great influence on this kind of thing, and he's Princess also became a student of Master Dharma, the Dharma. And so if you count that year, 511, you will find out a vegetarian meal or vegetarian diet in Chinese Buddhism has a history of 1,504 years. That's a very, very long time. And maybe at that time, white people, because I heard that white people came here maybe just 3 centuries ago, so maybe at that time you even don't know what kind of native African people are here, living in here. So something very old, it has a very long time, very long history for Chinese Buddhism to have this vegetarian diet. And also today, this kind of influence has continued. Even for householders, Buddhists in China do not eat meat. This is a very, very good thing. And here in Cape Town, I also asked some Chinese Buddhists and asked them, are the Chinese Buddhists here eating meat or not? And they answered me, said, not much. So I was thinking maybe just from Chinese Buddhism itself, they should not eat any meat. But maybe they are influenced from other traditions of Buddhism, so they eat a little bit. Maybe that's something I can figure out.
Okay. 我以前也很喜欢吃肉，尤其是吃肉包子特别喜欢。后来我戒肉以后呢，就有一次就忘了，就是中午已经吃了，就晚上已经戒完了肉，后来忘了有吃了这个肉包子，然后晚上的时候就想起来了，就今天中午我又吃了包子，本来是我已经戒完了的，然后想也没办法，已经吞完了，就是从此之后呢，一直就比较努力吧，就是一直努力，就是现在，就10多年了，就是所以有时候我们的这个可能习气啊，就刚开始很难断掉，但是呢，我们也想到，就是这个肉如果是 它只是一个包装的，就是在市场上买的话呢，可能大家都好像跟其他的这个包装的这种产品，水果啊，就这些没有什么差别的。但也许你知道是这个肉呢，就是实际上是跟每个棕色的它身体的部分，这个身体的部分呢，就是切下来也是很痛的。当它为了我们这个人类要食物而这个杀害的时候，那感受什么样的这种痛苦，付出什么样的代价？在这个时候呢，我们有一种思考的这种这个，这种余地。
So, I just to eat meat, and when I first started to eat meatless, I also made a mistake. Once, because I really like to eat bun with meat inside. When I had lunch, I had a bun with meat inside. That happened after I already take the vow to eat vegetarian diet. And then in the evening, I just remembered, I did eat some meat for lunch today. What should I do? Something like that. And then I think, anyway, I already swallowed it in, and it's maybe already digested, so I cannot make it up. So I think it is not easy for us to change our habit of our diet. Especially at the beginning, you may encounter some difficulty to do this, to start this. When you go to supermarket, when you see meat is on the counter, you just take it in, put it in your cart, and you think that's something for your food. However, if you think these are the body parts of those animals, when they were killed, when they were chopped off, when they were cut into pieces, they are suffering a lot, suffering that kind of out of our imagination. So if you're thinking that way, you will give yourself a space, give yourself a chance to become a vegetarian.
有些人认为可能不吃肉好像那个营养不够，我身体不太好，就是一定要吃肉。但没有想到，就是原来在肉食当中有很多的一些疾病，而如果你吃素的话呢，这种健康，我以前也专门研究过，所以对，人类的这种这个各方面的，包括你的这个身体的结构啊，就是身体里面的就是各方面的这种比如说就是蛋白啊，还有就是脂肪啊等等很多方面呢，在这个素食的观，就是从营养学和医学方面讲，应该是非常有意义的。那这样的话，一方面间接我们就放了很多的脂肪肾，那么同时呢，这种菩提心，就是口头上虽然没有说，但实际上呢，你在实际行动当中做。所以我为什么说韩传佛教在这方面很伟大呢？他们口头上就是也许说菩提心，也许没有说，但实际上呢，就这么多的佛教徒，包括现在有些统计，像光中国都是有这个1亿啊、3亿啊，就是这个确切的数目我不知道。如果这么多人真的是吃素的话呢，那就是放了多少个生命？就是这也是我们可能佛教徒也要值得思考的一个内容。
So, when we talk about meatless diet, or have vegetarian food or meals in the rest of our life, some people may see, that will make me have not enough nutrition, then I will get sick or something like that. However, if you think about the animal or the meat, it may carry virus or something like that, and we may have a greater chance to be ill, something like that. That's something we can think. And also, I also studied about the nutrition from animals and plants, compare them, and some of the studies also says about the animal protein and fat, all those things may not be that healthy as we think about. And if we take vegetarian meal, then it's also an indirect way for us to release captured animals. That's some virtuous thing that we do in Buddhism. And so why I said Chinese Buddhism, they are so great, I think one thing is what they're doing is actually action bodhicitta. Although they are like talking about bodhicitta, bodhicitta all the time, but they already do that. So I think there are some statistics says that there are maybe 100 to 300 millions of vegetarian in China because of this kind of Buddhist practice. I think that's really, really great. And that means a lot of animals were released by this kind of practice.
不管怎么样，我们这个发了大乘菩提心，或者说即使你没有发心，但我们应该以大乘的这种思想去帮助众生是非常重要的。弥勒菩萨就有个叫做是大乘经庄严论。大乘经庄严论里面有一句话就是对我影响很深，他是怎么说的呢？就是佛是当大乘，成熟住众生啊，就成熟成熟住众生，为他一善行前辈戒不严，就是有这么一句话，意思就是说呢，作为大乘的这种这个佛子啊，就我们发了这个菩提心的这个人呢，应该是用最大的努力来这个成熟众生，度化众生。那度化众生呢，为了一个众生的心里产生一颗善念、一颗善心，前辈完结当中就是做他的仆人，也是不生起厌烦心。我们要帮助一个人，就是要多少年、多少时间当中要努力去做的话，心里不会生起这种厌恶心和疲倦心。这种精神，我觉得我们很多人应该要值得去想想。
No matter we have already generated bodhicitta or not, I think we should learn from the ideas in Mahayana Buddhism to help other sentient beings. Because in the elements of Mahayana sutras by Bodhisattva Maitreya, he said as a practitioner, we should use our great diligence to ripen the continuum of sentient beings.And even just for helping one sentient being to have one thought of virtuous thinking, we should be tirelessly work hard, be diligent to do that, to help them. So, if we can, and especially if you have already generated bodhicitta, what you should do is to make the greatest effort at your best to help other sentient beings.To help them to generate virtuous thinking, even just for one thought of virtuous thinking, we should do our best. And even if we have to be their servant for thousands of kappa, we should still do that and do not feel tired. Don't get tired of doing this. Don't get tired of helping other sentient beings.
所以我们希望很多人可能认为自己修菩提心修得很不错的，但菩提心呢，在床上修的话应该很好的，在发作上这样修的时候呢，觉得自己真的成了菩萨一样的。但是我们要救一些可怜的众生，比如说你要帮助麻风病人，帮助艾滋病人，帮助一些什么疟疾的一些病人，或者说帮助一些孤儿。无家可归的老人，或者我们一些身边的一些穷人乞丐，那这个时候呢，我们自己的大乘菩提心呢，可能除了一团自私以外呢，也许可能你没有想到，就是别人需要你的爱。
So when we talk about cultivating bodhicitta, you may think And you may be satisfied with your practice when you are sit in your cushion. You think, oh, I'm really like a bodhisattva, I have bodhicitta, I'm so great. But if you are asked to help people with AIDS, to help orphans, to help widows, to help homeless people, then you will find your selfish thinking come out. And then you can realize, oh, I'm maybe not so great. And then you should really think, I should not be so selfish. Other people, other sentient beings really need my love.
有时候我看到世间当中一些没有任何信仰的，但是做很多很多的一些慈善的这个事业，而且做得无条件的非常伟大的一些事情，在这个时候通过他的一些这种案例来，我反观我自己，就自己认为是自己是一个大乘佛教徒，那么自己非常惭愧，就觉得呢，虽然自己也认为是自己已经发了大乘菩提心的，但是真正在某些事情上面的话呢，没有任何信仰的，有一些爱信人士的行为呢，就是也是不如。就这个时候，就自己觉得是自己还需要不断的去学习和修行。
So I look at some of the worldly people, they are non-believers, they do not follow any religion, but they are engaged themselves in charitable activities. They do a lot of great things.And when I see these cases, these stories, I just feel ashamed as a Mahayana Buddhist. Because especially, I already have generated bodhicitta, but what I'm doing really cannot compare to those people. And those people who waste great love, because what they're doing is really great. They are really helping people personally, just to go to them, help them.
我在这里也跟大家讲一下，因为我们这个道场呢，是阿公仁波切的道场。那么他呢，我们第一个藏族人，就是在西方这个弘扬佛法的人来讲呢，确实是跟我们的很多的年轻人，大概是在上个世纪的这个80-90年代，一直到他圆寂之前。对我们的藏族的这个很多年轻人，包括没有这个学费的呢，就特别多的人就是提供了这个学费，然后在我们有些包括语言包括文字的一些端称方面的话呢，就是他做出非常大的这个贡献。当然从你们每个人第一次就是从上师的加持和上师的一些传承，上师对你们的甘肃的这种发恩，包括你从你的这个皈依开始到这个对你的发恩，是更是我想象每个人来讲也是非常这个难以报答的。
He can spread the Dharma in the West and also in different places in the world. And start as a youth in the 80s and 90s of last century, and then later on, and then and also continue his activities until he passed away into the Parinibbana. I think.Not only what you already know, he also doing a lot of great things to give financial aid for people who cannot afford their education back in Tibet. And also, he helped to preserve Tibetan language and culture, all those great things. And personally for you, you may already feel the kindness that he gave to you when he gave your Dharma teachings.When you just started to take refuge in Buddhism, everything like that, he just had done a lot for all of us. So when you think about this, his kindness cannot really be repaid.
那么他就是也是为了这个众生面前就是实现无常，不幸呢 就是离开了这个人间。那么这是一方面讲，就是对大家来讲是非常的这种痛苦的事情，但另一方面来讲呢，我们这样的这种被爱就是化成一种动力，作为他的继承的这些弟子来讲呢，应该是更加努力的团结，更加努力的学习上师的这个所传下来的这些教法，就是大家都应该一起就是弘扬，就是他的这种传承，这是非常重要的。
So, even for his entering Parinibbana, I think it's also a way for him to help such beings because he was manifesting impermanence for us. So this is something sad or sad thing for us. But on the other hand, we should convert this sadness into drive force to work hard as his students. I think we should work together in a united way to study what he already told you or taught you and also spread the Dharma in his lineage in a harmonious way. I think this is something very important for you, for the center.
十多年前，我的上师，就金明通所有法王也圆寂了。当时我们学院的也接近上万人，然后他的传承弟子呢，也是应该说是在各个国家就是非常的多。对我们每一个弟子来讲呢，应该心里就是，就每一个人的心里呢，就是都，就有一个红色的太阳呢，就是就落于西山一样的，就是好像一种笼罩一种黑暗，就是就觉得是不知方向，就不知所措，就是有这样的一种感觉，有一片黑暗，一片空虚。但是我们后来，所有的这些人呢，就共同商量，我们说要继承就是上师的这个意愿的话呢，伤心没有用，哭了没有用。我们一定要把上师的这个传承的教法要不断的要坚持下去。后来我们学院的所有的这些就堪布啊、护法啊，全部都是反反复复的商量开会，然后呢就是把法王所办的这个学院呢要更加的这个管理好，把这个学习呢就是更加就是像以前他在世一样的就是去努力下去。那么今天已经十年过去了，我们还是一如既往的在这个学习和弘法。
So, more than a decade ago, my own teacher, Kimchenjimepunshu Rinpoche, also passed away into the Parinibbana. And at that time, close to 10,000 students from all over the world, we got together, and at that time, everyone just felt very sad because it's just like the sun is already went back into or down to the mountain on the west side. So the sun is already disappeared. And we are kind of like covered in darkness. There is no hope for us at that time. We just feel that way. But later on, we just get together, we discuss, we talk aboutWhat should we do? Because sadness is useless. We should not just indulge ourselves into sadness. What we need to do is to spread his teachings because that was very precious. So all the kempos, tukus, we get together, had numerous meetings. We have a lot of plans. We discuss how should we improve our administration and management and how to spread the Dharma. So now,another 10 years or over a decade has already passed. Now we are doing great in this management and also how to spread his teachings into the world.
所以我的根据自身的一些经验来跟大家提一个建议的话呢，那么你们凡是塔拉仁教的所有的这些传承弟子呢，应该要长期性的经常共同商量共同探讨如何继承就是他的 所传下来的这些法要，他的这个传承，他的道场，他的弘法利生的这个精神呢，要我们怎样延续下去，延续到百年、十年、百年，一直到一千年。那么这就是我们对上师的一种最大的报恩，也是对他的最大的一种这个供养。可能我们对他修一座塔，或者说是对他其他的任何的这种供养呢，他对他来讲不一定很重要。只要把我们的道场的这种法脉延续下去的话呢，这就是应该对一个上师来讲是可能最重要的。否则的话，我也经常看到有些上师圆寂了以后，就是道场就关闭了，弟子们呢就各自分散了，甚至呢就是中间也会发生各种各样的一些矛盾啊，就是有不愉快的事情啊。那这样的话，对上师来讲也是不一定是个很好的一种报恩。所以我们一般来讲呢，就是一个上师的离开呢，就是这是一个正常的，佛陀也会离开的，我们每一个人也会最后离开的。但是我们最重要的这个真理呢，就是要传导还有千千万万的有缘人，这就是我们的责任。
I'm using my personal experience to give you this advice. So as the students, I think you need to work together in a long term and discuss, work hard on how to spread his knowledge, his teachings, and his spirit of spreading the Dharma in the world. And in this way, your teachings that you have already got from him can exist or continue in this world for another 100 years, even 1,000 years, for a very, very long time. And I think this is the best way for you to repay his kindness, and also the best way to offer him. Because I think it's not important for you to just build a stupa for him. That's why I see a lot of people do that for their teachers. And what's more important is to continue his lineage, his teaching, and I think that will make him happy. And I also noticed that for some of the lineage or some of the centers, Dhamma centers, when their teacher passed away, their center just they get closed and the students just they go away, and there are a lot of conflicts and a lot of unhappy things happened. That's not something good. And their teacher will not be happy about that. So I think we should take the passing away of our teacher as something normal, because even the Buddha also entering Parinirvana. Ordinary people also has to die. So we should think this is something normal. But what we need to do is to spread his teaching and use those teachings to help all sentient beings and make numerous beings happy.
下面我用藏语念那个37诵佛子心的传承，然后完了以后就是在还有半个小时的时间跟大家提问。那么那么罗格小拉耶，刚刚就跟罗格没有走近，罗格端到谁的村子边？那么小东小林怎么管啦？到底搞什么级别？上这路，半点钟能走不三斤？他们就这对兄弟这样呢？对于老林西拉让那边，也只能比老林学不了些。他们就这些人可多命的了，到时候可能走了这些，年冬三到也还没办呢，年三过半也只老林人，年纪长了都吃吃得了药，这一长了些当面的了。Lang tu juga betul mungkin nak jangan bayar pangkat dia je lah, lain yang ni orang pangai nyomor ramjian tu, nama mereka give jangan give berubah tangan cula ni si, wimba tempat dia je lah, lain yang orang jumpa macam si susun macam berubah berubah macam cerita ni, ni jumpa orang nak sih jumpa orang, cendera orang dia je lah, lain, kadang jumpa tu pun pergi jangan tu pun kau bersih ni ambil berubah, siam dah ni jangan berubah berubah macam berubah, jumpa pangkat dia je lah, lain yang kau jadi tenan ni bazar ni. Yun de yar ngur lastar be jir ve shang yin dan ba rang li ve jang chi bren zam ba je che la ne rang ko ro zun ren chang bi min jir dan la yi su chi kyo bren de shir gan la kyam na ma la ba kom chu jam zhe je che la ne yin shen de zo kong gang so de ngun de ba le kim zhe ve to ve so de zhe shu la ba bian de ba na ma she je che la ne yin chu zum de ba sa zhe zer ba jang yi zum ji gen ji bu chu jin na ma jir ta ri kom bang zhe ton da ni ra je che la ne 同们定的到了，再也马东等了，到底这就是得正他一等他一身正，这是小人想就身边接这老人，等我马里到点多来上，就不想接这么些人。但是到底想起等我那当样，到这接这老人，是当到上完课，到跟到了他们抽空抽空进来呀，你当老师递送给我，那么得了，我接这老人。到了你把种子没种到，刚到他们给我出去那样，你这问个第一得把那么到了，你把接这老人。该几个到了明年拿走吧，东村这边做不了些那样，想不想起那两天你去用的这边接车老人，我们地不卫生，该几个我们厂里这样子跟妈来，得了给些金的些钱，给不能得把接车老人到各种这边添一米，得了这到了这人到了些那，那几大伯伯拉妈人到他不是接车老人呀，让到明白我们娘把让到。我们娘把我们比接我爷爷结婚过年都是那样，老妈人都给不到你接，小人能把接车老人，所以碰上啥都没有。差不清那当顿几大片老人专门做跟都到了那些讲，一般没把这些老人也，也不是照常专门去都是难度为，弄着多别人，这别话，这是娘不没有这个呢，恐怕没把这些老人那个些都是找我妈头，那个些当找我妈头那些人找我，都是讲别人就是带些人，像当年这么风格，让见到了这些老人都不用的，都不用的，两次接当着这种些讲这般别人就是刚来进这级别，我不能差了碰到这些老人，这是哪样的都能够什么什么都能准备他当，第二些呢。总之，咱们那原来没学建筑老人，也都我们也当出版了，也是地震家从出生到这边，那这边没得。现在我们建筑老人，都我们那做没那么些大人事，那这边作为阿当家的，但是我们这边我们建当出版这，这是大建筑老人，那像这么多被丽江东过，那是我们不那那没见过，但是难道那么没的？人把东建筑老人，这这没边让东门这边那，让东这边都把搞没呢，但是这边都把没把一次中央建筑老人。给我弄些多本家车机，弄些他们家人从台上走，台上跟那些人没办法，做把工本家车拉来，让他们把这。我这边伢人也过来，没事儿，老多的村通呢，就跟村的用他们家那些，村里村本家车拉来，人家那拉的咱们拉不动。要么那边就边休息，那怎么就那样？等台北也上等工本家车拉来，现在没那跑着去人家做不成，就拖不着那边，他当当讲苦怎么多。现在工本建筑老人因那人个吃了人个嘛，等那就把自己出门写纸呗，但是现在人个吃完了，等那房建筑老人因，要么问个建筑人，他给你办了那等你年纪了，他把接了就别干死，给你办门门建筑老人。嗯，因那你不管问个盘子做几人，都从工本写完年纪了，再去见到人到天了，那就把房建筑老人怎么这个人怎么这个几人，也是这就说出年纪，但是人家也都没跟我做做房建筑老人，要么工那年不落个为珍惜去。您不从容的吃素，您不当么？起码当不了些把建筑老人，多那刚到学生就是家人给生病，那个现在现在长得虚人的，现在这把建筑老人也得得准备准备给俺们太严重，等我再去辛苦了。那不然，等把些人就想起我把建筑老人，多就当就哪里送不动，当把那就送个金融建筑那的老人什么就，建筑老了弄不动动动，弄着嘛，像人啊，穷有钱，给把这边得劲嘛，是用多动，当别送了点别。建筑老人，村民老不了生，关键建筑小把老钱了。罗马当这当铺盖有钱，盖当忙这拉手你比，但把咱们就做不能再动手。对了，像我给援助啊，跟屯东跟中乡就先做个，这东西我们太难忙那边，乡里总共带动总不是一般的，让人来旁边屯东弄到这个什么，怎么他们我去认真陪到一下了吧？我，嗯哼。可以有什么问题，就我们互相互动交流。
Do you have any questions? You know, we're speaking about meat and how we shouldn't eat meat. What about vegetables that use chemicals and pesticides, killing lots and lots of beings on the vegetables that are growing, even many more beings than one cow, for instance?And what about cheese and milk that's made from animals who are also being treated badly? Do we also, I mean, why didn't we talk about becoming vegan? Why only vegetarian?
如果奶酪也不吃的话，当然是很好的。我也没有要求你一定要吃奶酪，没有这么说。这是第一个。然后第二个，如果这个没有农药的。这个素菜呢，当然是更好的。 但是蔬菜呢，就是加农药，就是并不是我们就让他们加的，就所以，我们就是连这个蔬菜都不吃的话呢，就是可能，也有一定的困难。我们也不可能说连这个蔬菜也不吃，所有都不吃。但是实际上，肉食的话呢，就是为了肉而杀的，就是所以说这是有非常明显的这个差别。因此，我们，在。这个杀动物方面呢，有些是直接而杀的，有些是间接而杀的。如果我们吃蔬菜的话呢，这是农民他在利用的过程当中，就我们最好是不要用这种农药。但即使用的话呢，我们是吃的蔬菜，我们不是吃的肉，所以他的佛教里面他的发心方面有一定的差别。我们不是说没有过失，就是间接肯定有过失的。
First thing, when we talk about eating vegetables, I'm not saying that it's perfect. It does bring harm to some of the beings or insects or things like the pests, those things. There must be something wrong there too. But to just address your question in two separate parts, the first thing is the cheese. So you said why you don't ask us to be vegan instead of just vegetarian. People said, I didn't ask you to, you have to eat cheese. So do you understand that?
No.
Okay, so Kimbo said, he didn't say you have to eat cheese. You can choose the option to not eat cheese to be a vegan. That's something, if you can do that, it's even better. You are very good example, so that for the cheese, and then for vegetables, then it's something maybe a little bit tricky, but because when we say we go to buy vegetables and eat vegetables, we didn't ask the farmers to add the pesticide. We don't have the motivation to kill them, and although it's not perfect, to survive, we have to eat something. And to eat vegetables, that is the smallest harm that we can bring to beings, then we can still also survive. That is something between direct and more obvious and indirect, less obvious harm that we bring to sentient beings or beings. So a little bit subtle way to distinguish these two. Yeah, so when we talk about this kind of practice, we do emphasize a lot about the motivation to.
老师你好，我今天心情非常激动，因为我看到你本人了。那我的问题呢，就是说想请教老师，是因为我自己在学习过程中，就是说这个菩提心，因为你今天谈了菩提心，所以我想了解一下这个出离心。就是说这个出离心的一个概念，还有出离心跟菩提心的一个关系，因为我觉得这两者是有很紧密的关系，然后我自己本人也在尝试的去理解他们之间的这个关系，就是说理解好这个关系，可能才能更好的发这个菩提心，可能这是其实我的问题，就是如何能够很好的去发这个菩提心，发这个愿。因为您也说到我们人的这个习性，我们是很自私的，我们怎么可以，我们都还没有醒悟，我们怎么可以让发一个大愿让别人也去觉悟。同时就是说这个出离心好像也是一个很重要的概念，就是您书里面也谈到，所以我今天正好。
你有出离心和菩提心之间的差别，出离心是什么样呢？就是宗喀巴大师有个三主要道论，他这里面讲宁曾根的他的东尼路凶那地曾根中结伴了，就是白天晚上都想获得解脱，就不断的想获得解脱的话，那么这就是所谓的出离心。就是说就我们在这个三界轮回当中没有什么快乐的，我一定要远离一切的痛苦获得解脱，就这样的心态呢，就是叫做是出离心。然后菩提心呢，我们刚才也讲了，就是愿众生就是获得无过的，就是这么一个，就是也有带有白心带有智慧的这么一个心。其实这两个心呢，就我们作为一个就比较深一点的佛教的研究和修行者来讲是非常重要的。然后在这个基础上面呢，还有一个叫做无二慧， 也就是说，我们对整个所有的万事万物的法呢，就是最后都要通达这个空性，就是这样的。所以这叫做三主要道，就是所以我们在修行过程当中，出离心和菩提心、无二智慧，如果没有它的话，可能我们的三法是成为一个人间的这个人天福报啊，或者说人间的一个快乐的印，就是它不能就是就佛教最高层的一个这种修行。
So, when we talk about bodhicitta or the mind of renunciation, they do explore from each other by the mind of renunciation. If you read Tsongkhapa's the three principles of the path, you will find it, and he said, if you wish to be liberated from samsara, day at night, that is called the mind of renunciation. And you wish to be free from all suffering and reach liberation, that is the mind of renunciation.And then bodhicitta, I just mentioned earlier, if you have the wish to help all sentient beings reach the Buddhahood, that is bodhicitta, and it also has the aspect of compassion and also the aspect of wisdom. And then there is another one which is called the wisdom of non-duality, that is the wisdom of emptiness. We view, we perceive all phenomena as emptiness.So these three are the three principles of the path to enlightenment, of course. So without these three things, all our practice, we may call it Buddhist practice, but it can only bring us the enjoyment and happiness in human and God realms. All our practice can only be the causes of happiness in these two realms. It's not the ultimate, it's not the...The most profound practice in Buddhism.
Mm-hmm. Yes. He used the word happiness and suffering a couple of times, and I would like to know what his meaning is by happiness, by the word happiness. What does that mean?
No.有吃的，有穿的，然后没有什么，就这种身心的这种压力，还自己觉得就是感受一种陶醉在一种喜悦的状态当中，这叫做是乐。所谓的苦呢，就是也有身苦和心灵的这种痛苦。那么身体的痛苦，你产生这个疾病呢？就各种这种包括一些监狱里面关着的这种身体的折磨，心灵的痛苦虽然有吃有穿，但是一直不开心呢，有些人想自杀，就这些叫做是痛苦，心灵的痛苦。所以这个求快乐，就每个众生都要求快乐，而不愿意再感受痛苦，但很多人就是想法和行为颠倒而走。
So, first is happiness. People said, what is happiness? We can think, if you have abundant clothing, you have adequate or abundant or a lot of food, and you don't have any stress, indulge in a kind of joy, that is happiness. That is the happiness that we all want to have. And for suffering,It has mental suffering and physical suffering. For physical suffering, you may suffer from disease or being imprisoned and being maltreated. That's the physical suffering. And about mental suffering, you may be unhappy all the time and even thinking about committing suicide. That's the mental suffering. So we all want happiness and do not want suffering.But what we are doing right now are actually, a lot of times, are the causes for suffering. So our action and our wish contradict with each other.
印度的发乘论师在释量论里面说，依靠这个可爱的对境就是产生快乐，依靠痛苦的对境而 怎么说，就不约意的对境而产生嗔恨心，嗔恨心和贪心的对境呢，就是乐和苦而产生的。
And also, people quoted from Dhammakirti's commentary on cognitive reasoning, and it said, so just relying on the objects that we wish for or what we want, then we have desire.And relying on these objects that we do not like, we dislike, kind of disgusted by those things, then we have aversion. And from desire and aversion, we have suffering. So both things can make us have suffering and suffer from those things.
Tsongkhapa 大师是，在藏地来讲，共称为三大位数，一个是萨迦派的萨迦班智达，更改简称；一个是尼玛巴的隆钦仁杰，还有一个是Tsongkhapa 大师。他们确实是造了非常珍贵的论典，他的智慧是极其不可思议。他造的大的论点呢，有菩提道次第论和密宗道次第论，但这两个归纳起来的话，就是我刚才讲的三主要道论，就是其实三主要道论内容不多，就前面的道当中主要讲这个出离心的必要，然后出离心是怎么样修，就是然后讲这个没有菩提心的这个就缺点。然后菩提心就怎么样这个运用，然后讲没有无二慧呢，就是前面的菩提心和出离心也不能真正的获得解脱，就是最后呢，就是一定要需要通过无二的智慧来，就是通达这个佛的教言。那最后就是说，无二慧也是指光一个证悟单空不行，就是一定要证悟大空心，就大概。他宗喀巴大师把这部论点刚才的问题联系起来的话，那就是讲这三点。
So in Tibet, we see there are three emanations of Bodhisattva Manjushri. Jetsungkhapa is one of them. The other two are the
文殊菩萨的化现，就是他文殊的化现。
对对对，我是这么说。And then the other two are one is from the Sakya school.His name is Genga Jamtsen, and also called Sakya Bentita. And another one is from Nimapa, and his name is Lungchin Rabjam. So these three are three emanations of Bodhisattva Manjushri. And about Jetsungkhapa, we can see he had a lot of commentaries. As the most famous one is the Great Treatise on the Stages to...enlightenment, that one. And also, he had two volumes. One volume is about Mantrayala, another one is about Sutrayala. And if you summarize those big volumes of books, then you have this one small book, which is called The Three Principles of the Path. And in that commentary, he first talked about the necessity of generating the mind of renunciation.And then how to generate, how to cultivate the mind of renunciation. And then if you don't have the mind of renunciation, what is the bad thing about that? What kind of defects will come out? And also how to use bodhicitta in your practice and your daily life. And then last one, he emphasized, without the wisdom of non-duality, then we cannot reach liberation.And even for the wisdom of non-duality, if we can only reach or realize the approximate emptiness, that's not enough. We have to realize the great emptiness.
You mentioned the example of Lama Tsongkhapa who as I understand it, is one of the originators of the Gelugpa school of Tibetan Buddhism. And here, I think in South Africa, there are maybe three schools that are maybe have some strength. So it's Gelugpa, and this is Kagyu Center, and then there's a smaller group of Nyingma practitioners. And the Sangha is quite small here. So sometimes some practitioners are going between different teachers from these different lineages. And I understand the importance of sticking with one lineage because of the Guru Yoga and all these kinds of things. But what do you do in a place where the Sangha is so small, and you is it better to stick with one lineage and one teacher, or is it if you have a good teacher and the Dharma teachers are so few here, is it better to go wherever the Dharma is?
这个问题提得很好。作为一个学的时间比较长的人来讲呢，应该就不舍弃自己的宗派的原则下呢，多学一点也可以。如果学的时间不长的人呢，可能只学一个好一点，因为学的如果不长呢，就是今天去听这个，明天去听那个，就这样的话，很有可能原来的他的自己的所依止的这些上师啊、宗派啊，就是这些都会背叛，就是最后呢，就是他自己也不知道。就现在我们在中国也是有很多今天去这个，就像是一个新闻记者采访一样的，就是到处都去的，但最后自己呢，就是什么都没有得到的，就是这样的。如果自己在某一个道场当中待的时间比较长，自己的心性不会容易给别人转移，在这种情况下呢，有必要的时候，就是其他的善知识来的时候呢，我也以清净心，就是去依止接受，就是很多上师的这些教言呢也可以，但是原则呢，就是尽量的就跟着一个自己的宗派的话呢，这是人很稳重的一种态度，而且对自己的这种上师呢，就是也是一直很长时间。我那天看到阿公仁波切的在英国的有些弟子啊，就是已经一直了40多年了，非常敬仰，我很随喜，就觉得我不知道这边有没有这样的，就是就这种这个传承呢非常好的，就是人要做什么事情的要一直要终身这样下去的话呢，就是才有这个修行的长久。
So it depends. If you are a practitioner for a long time, you can go to other places to get teachings, to receive teachings, and without losing your own lineage or your own tradition, and that is something, yeah. And if you are just a beginner, it's better for you to just follow one tradition to study it further. Because for some of the people, when they go to other places, they just abandon what they have learned and also give up to their teachers in the past. That's something not very good. Because some practitioners, they just act like a journalist.They go everywhere, learn about everything, but they gain nothing. If you are in one center and have studied for a long time, and you are very confident your faith will not degenerate if you go to other places to learn more teachings, then you can go with a pure mind to accept the teachings from other teachers.I think that is something very principal, because if you can rely on a teacher for a long time, that's also a way to show that you have a very stable personality, and also it's very beneficial for yourself. And this time when I was in UK, and I found that there are a student of Akung Rinpoche, he has relied on Akung Rinpoche for more than 40 years. that's something amazing. I think that's a very good example for us. We should really rely on a teacher for a whole life, for a very, very long time. That's wonderful.
刚到时间，可以了。
Okay, maybe it's a good time.
有回响吗？
And do you have a closing prayer?
Yoga-nan-ji-ra-long-tru-pa-yi-tru-pa-tsu-lay-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-tru-va-t